23% of our population was paying taxes in 2013-14. Today that number has gone up slightly to 6%. Today also we are classified as a fairly high tax nation. The ultimate objective is for the government to move to a 25% corporate tax rate. Effective tax rate for corporates can vary between, 18-20% to about 44%. The move towards GST is good because it avoids the cascading effect and you only pay tax on the value addition. Ultimately, the government has to decide if it is going to run a fiscal deficit of 3%, if that's the aspiration, then it has to live with that. Relieving or making that ratio a little flexible would do no harm for the economy.
Taxation in India, what ideology or what theory is governing our taxation?
So I think the overall framework is to collect as much as possibly the state can, because historically we've had very few direct taxpayers actually paying taxes. We had only 3% of our population was paying taxes in 2013-14. Today that number has gone up slightly to 6%. So we have larger number of people within the tax net, direct tax net, and the total amount of tax that is collected has also gone up. It's grown in proportion with the number of people who've now in the tax net. But the framework has been, for the government, has been we were a very high tax nation in our development stages. When we were in the 80s and 90s, we were a very high tax nation. Today also we are classified as a fairly high tax nation. But if you look at the secular trend, our tax rate have come down. We are trying to make our taxation a little more efficient, get more people into the tax net so that we can reduce the taxes on people who are actually paying the taxes. The ultimate objective is for the government to move to a 25% corporate tax rate, which is also a direct tax, and to get rid of all the exemptions, because the effective tax rate for corporates can vary between 18-20% to about 44%. So that's, and there are very complex tax laws surrounding that. So the idea is to make it simple, get rid of all the exemptions, and make more people, get more people into the tax net. That's the sort of idea behind the current tax regime. And similarly for direct taxpayers, get as many of them as possible, make it online, make the transactions, enable the transactions by using the computer or using the internet. And in fact, the finance minister recently said in her budget speech that what she would do is that have pre-filled form for taxpayers so that it becomes very easy for individuals to pay taxes. So the overall approach is towards simplification, to rationalize our tax laws, and to collect as much as possible for the meeting the expenditure of the government. Of course, there is also the fiscal deficit and the fiscal space for the government, which is an issue. But as far as the tax regime is concerned, the aim is towards simplification and rationalization and using technology to the extent that is possible.
But sir, as far as indirect taxes are concerned, a person who is paying 10% or 20% or 30% taxes is also paying taxes on paying indirect taxes, means getting his fuel at 30-40% tax or whatever the tax slabs are, 18% or whatever existing tax slabs of various service and goods. So in a way, why India failed on the most affirmative action to alleviate poverty, for example, health and education, whereas West Europe is doing better on these.
So the cascading effect of indirect taxes has actually been addressed by the GST. There are many issues with the implementation of the goods and services tax, like the multiplicity of tax rates, and you have several exemptions. And then there is a contract between the center and the states that the states would be compensated for the next 5 years for the loss of revenue as a result of implementation of the GST certain states. So there is, the move towards GST is good, because it avoids the cascading effect and you only pay tax on the value addition. And the other good thing about the GST is that it encourages compliance. Although for compliance, we need other factors as well. We need the government tax administration to become more friendly. We need less litigation in taxes, and we need a behavioral change both on the part of people to pay their taxes and to get, as you were saying, to get the quality of services that they deserve because they are paying taxes in the form of public goods, in the form of schools, and in the form of hospitals, and on the part of the tax administration to become more friendly. So far, as we know, and very popular, you know, Bollywood films and very popular narrative around the tax administration and civil society has been one of an adversarial relationship. There has been a huge trust deficit between the civil society and the tax administration, and we need to bridge that. And one way to bridge that is to use technology, and the other way to bridge that is through a behavioral change to demonstrate to people that their tax money is actually being used for social welfare programs, is being used for health, is being used for education, it is being used for, you know, building public infrastructure like roads, building rural roads, which is what the purpose of taxation is. Unfortunately, what has happened in India is because of past government debt, because of government borrowings, 2/3 of the revenue of the government gets spent on past debt contracted, i.e. interest payments. A lot of it gets spent on subsidies. Therefore, the fiscal room for the government to make capital investments, to make investments on education and health and roads and public infrastructure, that gets reduced. So the fiscal space is limited. I agree with you. Ultimately, the government has to decide if it is going to run a fiscal deficit of 3%, if that's the aspiration, then it has to live with that and therefore manage its expenditure within that constraint that it has set for itself. Although I think in situations where the capital expenditure is necessary, where you need public money to crowd in private investment, relieving or making that ratio a little flexible would do no harm for the economy.
So a similar question, most high-tech countries invest heavily to finance free education and healthcare along with various social security schemes. Why are we only focusing on taxes and not providing quality education and health in proportion to that, given the percentage of budget for education and health in various, I mean, if they compare to the best?
So most of expenditure on education and health that is made is done by private people themselves, by civil citizens, by civil society or by citizens. So the expenditure on education is about 3% of GDP. The expenditure on health is about 1% of GDP. All the other expenditure is made by the people themselves. So in some sense, there's a private provisioning of public goods. So this is a failure of the government to be able to provide good quality health and good quality education to its people. And it's not just throwing money at the problem. You also need to have skilled teachers, you need to have skilled, you know, doctors who are willing to work in areas that are underserved or unserved. So it's just not a money problem, although I agree with you that part of the problem is a money problem, resources problem. But part of it also is the problem of doctors, lack of doctors. Part of the problem is a lack of good quality teachers. Now, if you give the state the flexibility to decide, because, you know, education is a state subject, you can give the state the flexibility to decide what the state wants to spend the money on. Do you want to spend the money on infrastructure, or do you want to spend the money on wages of teachers, or do you want to spend the money on you know, developing a better curriculum? It depends. The state, let the state decide what it wants to do. Do not force you know, either payment on wages, or do not force payments on, for building, you know, buildings, etc. Let the states decide.
So why, you know, sometimes there are arguments that high tax is unjust in India because the parents are forced to keep, you know, to keep their children in private schools, or are out of pocket, health expenditure is multiple times higher than France, UK or US, yeah. 4 to 6 times higher than these countries were developed. So don't you think education and health are state subjects, and many of the tax hikes are imposed through CIS and surcharge, which are not shared with the states? So given the weak notion of social contract between the state and citizens of India, Don't you think it is necessary that it's visible to citizen that revenue mobilized is going to the right causes?
Right. I mean, that is something that we are moving towards. In fact, you know, if you look at the best practice in public finance, the government tells the citizens of a country where the money has been spent and how it has been spent. And there is some transparency and therefore there is accountability. That is something that we need to do. Our performance on health and education has not been good. And in fact, we have underperformed. The state has underperformed in provision of health and education services. Where we have succeeded, and education is not a homogeneous entity, right? You have higher education, then you have secondary education and primary education. The area of the biggest problem in India has been primary education, where the state is directly responsible. Of course, there is private primary education also, but where the state has really failed, I think, is in primary education. The state has done relatively better in higher education. We have public sector higher education, which has done pretty well. And India has become, you know, the education, one of the, you know, better education providers amongst emerging markets. And now we have, in the top 200, we have our institutions of excellence in the top 200 in the world. But where we have not done well is primary education. That's something where the learning outcomes are not good, where the quality of teachers leaves a lot to be desired. So that's where the state has to make a big impact. And that responsibility, as I was saying, should be given to the states to do. When the center gives the money, the state should decide what it wants to spend the money on. On health, again, on primary health care is where we haven't done well. In tertiary health care, India again is doing pretty well and is exporting a lot of medical services as well. But so neither health nor education is a homogeneous entity. There's a lot of heterogeneity within health and education, and I think we need to focus on primary education, improve the quality of outcomes of primary education, of course spend more money in it, and also improve the outcomes of health. In fact, how the health of a child is in the first 100 days determines what is going to happen to the child in the future. So those first 100 days of first 3 years of a child's life are extremely important. And that's where I think where India, in terms of nutrition, in terms of the quality of health interventions, has not done as well.
So my last question to you is, how can we make outcome of outlays more accountable in order to improve public sector delivery?
So we have to keep questioning the government. There are lots of NGOs, there are lots of institutions that question the government on the quality of its outcomes. And there are, now the government itself is saying that they're going to move, instead of an outlay budget, they want to move to an outcome budget. I think these are institutions that, think tanks and NGOs that need to push the government. Of course, we have the media that continuously questions the government, like yourselves and people, question the government on what it's spending on. So I think it has to be a multifaceted approach where we need to question the government on both the quantity of the outlays as well as the quality of the outcomes.
Thank you for talking to us.